Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today I'm continuing with the series of videos I'm recording about Neo4j data science package. I will talk about centrality algorithms. As usual, I prepare an output that later on I will post to the repository and you will be able to go through it and review in your local environment all what we are going to discuss here. What are centrality algorithms? Well, these algorithms, the main aim is to identify the importance or to score the importance of a single node inside a graph. There is different perspectives how you can get this score, how you calculate this score with different purposes or with different use cases, and we will cover then some of them in this tutorial, because they are not all of them implemented in Neo4j GDS library, and we will cover those that only are in completely implemented on the library, not others that are in other stages. So it's probably, if you didn't see the other videos I uploaded before, in GDS there is different levels, no, in terms of the how mature is the algorithm in the library, and then on there is a production quality level. This is the algorithm is fully tested, that is working, is completely incorporated to the library, and then on there is alpha and beta. Alpha obviously is like you have some knowledge about software development. Is a alpha release is a early stages where you are still, many things can change. Beta, well, is almost close it to a final release, and then on production quality is obviously something that you hand over to the production team and is already in production working on. So we are only going to cover the ones, the algorithms that are in production level quality. There is other that are already, how to say, working on them. We will not cover them because, as you can imagine, this can change. We don't know exactly what is going to be the final implementation. In any case, from those that are in production quality, they are the most relevant, and even I'm going to be completely open to you, some of them I never use it in my professional career, and some of them it's clear business, between the centrality, page run, article run, they are well known algorithms. These ones probably they are corner cases for very specific use cases, so no worry with what you are going to see here. I think for now you had more than enough to calculate centrality in Neo4j. So as I say in previous videos, all these algorithms had mostly the purpose of create features for our kind of the phase of feature engineering that we follow when we are creating a data set to train a model. Here you can see this similar to that. We analyze the graph looking for different features, different perspectives of the nodes, the relations in between the nodes, and this is one of the ways to do it, analyzing how important versus different formulas, if you want to say that, the node, and then with this we can create a feature which later on we can use in training an algorithm. Okay, before to start, I'm using the sandbox. Probably in the videos I uploaded before, you see you had all the complete documentation how to either install or access the sandbox in Neo4j, or install the Neo4j desktop, and In that case, also upload the airport database. That is the one that we are using in these tutorials. The easiest, and if you want to follow my advice, go to the sandbox, choose the template data science. You have there a library, sorry, a database that you can extend for 10 days. You can complete all the tutorials exactly the same that I'm doing here, just changing the connection details. And for now, if you are starting or you especially with the GDS package, don't do it in the Neo4j desktop because it's gonna be more complicated. Moreover, this is free. You can use it for 10 days. When it finished, you start again. You can request as much how to say instances as you want. Once it's terminated, you have maximum 10 days. You can make a backup. Then on you take or you can take the backup and create a new data science and restore the backup, or you can just simply run all the notebooks again and continue. In my opinion, my advice, go for the sandbox. It's gonna be easy for you. So the sandbox at the same time come directly with in this database installed, the airports worldwide airports database, and then you don't need to install it additionally, and moreover, you don't need to create any script to create the relationships or the property keys. So it's up to you. My advice, create a template in the sandbox like this. Here you don't see the data science template because I already had one, and you can only have one project with one data science template. But if you see it, it will be another tab like this with data science instance, and then you just check it and create it. That simple than that. And once you have it, you just simply will get something like that. And you will get you can open is getting the prompt, and you can get here either here in the actions you had the option to extend and connection details. You had the password, the URL, etc. How to connect with the different languages that are supported, and backups if you want to backup, and then on continue in your local environment. Okay, what we have here, we have different nodes, different relationships, and different properties. Surely, if you start it from scratch, you will not see exactly the same that you are seeing, because here I already create some additional relationships and some additional properties, and then probably you will not see hash underscore route underscore weight. You will not see page rank weight. You will not see no airport weights, and you will not see region airports. I will explain you now what is. Also, I'm not going to enter into details about Cypher, about how and graph database works. I suppose you know. I just going to go through how to use the GDS library. And as commented in the previous videos, if somebody thinks, or most of you thinks, that it's necessary to create some videos about how to use or what are graph databases, and how to use Cypher, these kind of things, let me know on the chat, on the comments on the video, and we will do something. No worries. So we have these nodes, these relationships, these attributes. And then we are going to work with that. So in the node airport, that is going to be one of the key on this tutorial. We have these attributes. We will be using as well the relationships hash route. Well, you see here this mess because I already create some other relationships, and it's really now not very easy to understand anything. But well, the relationships are in between nodes at the same in the same class or in between nodes of different classes, and either classes or relationships can have attributes, and well, again, it's as much as this grows, is a little bit more complicated to visualize, because you see here is a lot of relations. No, you can click on one of them. So you see here, this is a relationship, has road weight with an attribute weight. If you click here, you have the details. You can click as well in the hash weight. Let me, that one is hash road. There is another here with another attribute. Probably we can go through some of them. Distance, exactly. Yeah, here we have distance, another attribute of the another relationship. So you can filter. Probably we can show only some of them. Three, for example, and check. There is yeah, here we are just matching anything that are that has a relationship hash root. Usually in this database it should be an airport that had a relationship hash root. In any case, this is a little bit messy because I already created some of them that I will cover now when we go through the notebook. In city, we had other relationships, like in region, for example. This is a relationship that just tells us different nodes that are in the region, in a region. The region, I don't see anything here. So this is exactly the region. So the hierarchy is continent. Inside continents, you have relation with countries, with a relationship in country. Then there is region, that is connected with let me rephrase this. There is continent, that is the root. Then on there is country, there is relation that is in country with the north country. Then we had airport is connected with country as well. So there is a relation that is in country, that is this relation is connected with the north airport, with the north city, and with the north region. And then we know we had airports with are connected with as well with other airports through the relationship hash road, with the relationship in city are connected with the node city, and with the relationship in region they are connected with the node region. So we have multiple nodes, multiple relations, multiple connections in between nodes, and nodes at the same in the same class and nodes in different classes. So the property keys that we see here, they are some of them are belongs to the node, some other belongs to the relationship, mostly to the nodes. The only ones that belongs to the relationships are weight and distance. Distance belongs to the hash root relationship, and if you check one of them, let me check one of them. Let's extend. Wait, it's difficult to get one of them. Distance, you see here, distance in between two airports, and in region, hash road weight is something that I customize myself. No, let's take a look what you have. Has road weight, here you have it. Yeah, I will explain you now what is that, no worries. Let's close all these graphs, because well, everything that you are doing here, you can do it as well on the with the SDK, and this is exactly what we are gonna do. So I'm connecting here to the GRAD database, as you see here. I'm using the client included in LangChain, in the library LangChain. You may know that LangChain Pro is fully integrated with Neo4j, not only for vector store, also for a component like tool for rack or for other purposes. So you can use this, you can use this connection. This is only a wrapper of the Python driver that you had available. If you look at the connection you have here, connect via drivers. So LangChain driver, LangChain connection is only a wrapper of the Neo4j driver. You can do it like this, or you can do it like you saw. So here we connect, and then on we are going to start with PageRun. PageRun is the probably the broadly well known algorithm in terms of the centrality. It was developed by Google. We are not going to enter into the details how they calculate the score, but essentially your takeaway is a way is calculating the an score counting the number of incoming relationships, and depending how you configure the PageRun is also calculating this according to the way that has this relationship. If you don't say anything, it's just counting the number of relationships that has this node. It's not, if you specify that it has to be weighted, it's also take into account the weight of the relationship. As I mentioned before, you can have attributes at a node level and also at relationship level. Usually, the attributes at relationship level are use it by to calculate the weight of that relations. Just imagine that you have 20 relations or n relations to from one node or coming or going to another node, and you can specify or imagine that you have two connections to the same node, but using you have a preferred route. No, you can specify, for example, this connection is more preferable than this other. Even that they both had the same source and the same destination, you can give a weight to one of them that is the preferable route to use. This is, for example, when you are working with networking routing. This is something that you do very. You just had multiple connections in between the same node. You had your connections in between different routers, and then on these connections are the two or three of them are working with the maximum priority, and the other two, for example, you have five, three of them are working as with the high priority, and two of them are used only in case of problems. The same happens with DNS. You have you can resolve the same name with different registries, and every registry have a different weight. No, this is exactly the same concept, but the main how to see this algorithm, how it works, is you just calculate the importance of the nodes counting the number of relationships that have that specific node. How you can see this, because this algorithm was developed in the web environment, this is seen that is a node. If a web page had a lot of links to another pages, or other pages had at the same time many links pointing to this website, and then if you had a lot of links either going to other places or coming to you, especially coming to you, this site is more relevant than others that nobody is pointing to them. It's just going to show you who is more, where usually people wants to go. No? One notice as well in everything that I'm going to describe here, probably this graph that we are going to use You will not see exactly the importance of using one of these algorithms because not all the algorithms are useful in, for all graphs. No, you need to understand exactly how the algorithm works in order to use it for your specific design or for the specific design of your graph. What I want to say with that, well, you may see here 6 or 7 different algorithms, but not other applies to all use cases. And then this is something that you need to analyze before to apply it. I just want to present you, I create some kind of the mockup design, but you will see that some of the scores that are provided probably doesn't have much sense in this graph. But what I want to just show you is, well, we have this here, you will see how to apply it, and then go deep into the documentation and understand if you can apply it to your use case or not. Okay, before I start to apply the algorithms, I create some attributes, some properties in the North Airport. Here, what exactly I'm doing is I try to match where I'm matching the country. The country also it had to exist a relation in between an airport and that country, and then on once this is matched on the graph, you extract the node M, which is the country, the node P, you count the number of relationships, and you rename this as a count, as a number of airports. And then on we set an attribute in M, in country, with the name known airports, and this is the count of airports that have a relationship airport to country. A relationship in each country that comes from source airport destination country, and we do the same, and we set that an attribute at in the node airport. We do the same in region. We had a node airport which had a relationship with a region, and we do exactly the same to the attribute that we set up in the at airport level is country airport in this case, and in this case is region airport. We don't care here, it was just a try, I wanted to do it at the same time, but finally we will not use it. Then on here what I'm creating is an attribute, a new relationship. The relationship is going to be in between airport and airport. In between airport and airport. And then what I'm doing here is just creating as well a mock-up, something to later use. Probably, again, it has absolutely no sense because you will see the calculation here is something very silly that I invented. It probably means nothing. But I wanted to see how you can create features to later on use in your feature engineering and create attributes not only with the GDS algorithms, also with pure Cypher language. Here I just try to find Nose Airport, which had the relationship hash road with other airports, usually all of them, but well, I just specify exactly I want airports which had a relationship with another airport with the name hash road, and then I take from this match the node, the relationship, the source airport, destination port. I take the region airports I calculated above as region airports, the country airports also calculated above, and the runways. This is the number of the pistes that have every airport. And with this, I create a new relationship with the name hash road underscore weight, and the weight with an attribute that is going to be weight, and then I just make a calculation. Don't consider the calculation as something that makes sense, because it probably makes no sense. I just invented it. Just to give you an example of how you can do that. Don't try to analyze what this means that because it has no meaning. Then on how you are going to work with the GDS, usually or you, mostly you will create always a projection. The projection is like doing a view. You are familiar with the databases. You can create a view that is the composition of 2D, or multiple tables, and you can create even calculated attributes, calculated columns, and then projection is exactly the same. It's a view of a table or multiple tables in your database. Here the projection is how you extract part of your graph, and with this part of your graph, with this subset, you will create an attribute. What we are going to do here, we just create a projection with the name graph airport. We will use the node airport, and the relationship has road weight, and we will take the attribute of this relationship with the name weight. This is exactly what we create here. Okay, so you call the GDS graph projection, and you have created a view of your graph. Now we can calculate the estimate of how much memory we are going to use doing that. In this case is not very important because the database is not very big. Let me show you. We had 8,000 nodes, 74,000 key relationships. This is very small database. But you will see when you try to visualize, it's becoming slower because it's the client, all the rendering is very, very slow. But in under the hood, the calculations are going very fast with this size. But just imagine a database in Facebook, Meta, or in LinkedIn, or in Amazon, that they are using these technologies, the sizes that they are managing, millions and millions of nodes with hundreds of relationships in between them. So this can be very slow. So many times before to apply one of these algorithms, it's good to use the right estimate and to try to run and see how long it takes, and also the memory that you need to consume. And then over here, when you do a string, when you use the method string of the page run or anything that you had in GDS, had the method string, you are doing exactly the same that you do in a database when you do a query, when you do a search, a select in this case, no? Select, blah, blah, blah. You make a join, you calculate an aggregated column. This case string is doing exactly the same. It's just to giving you a simile, no? And then here we calculate, we create a graph with the name graph airport, and then we are just doing a select using this view, and then we yield. We are going to create a. We are going to use the page run. The page run will create an score. Every node that you select here, airport, with this relationship, and if you specify weighted, we will see it now, it will take into account the attribute in the relationship. It's not only, it will count the number of incoming relationships. So here in this first query, we just let me run it again. Probably let me drop it before. Here I just put you as well how to drop a projection. This is also important because you cannot run a projection. You destroy the projection, and then now we create it again. Is just this one, and then we just estimate the time. Here again, the number of nodes is nothing, and now we are going to here just print the airport description and the score that you get using this projection. You stole by default, you stole the Neo4j in the sandbox. It's already coming with page run. You see here, this is all. Once you install it, this installation by default is coming already with a page run. The page run that we are calculating here is you had to get exactly the same number that you have in page run, because it's the same calculation. If you don't say anything here in this calculation, it's an unweighted calculation, so it doesn't take into account this property. And then on is how it's done in the default dataset in the data science template. And then on, if you want to run it and make the comparison, it had to be everything that you get here, it had to be exactly the same that you get in that you already had on the database. Okay, so we had Chicago, Denver, Huntsville. So this is giving us an score. This is we are covering all airports. We have 3,000, practically 4,000 airports in this database, and it's creating an score that gives you an idea of the number of incoming relations that you have to every specific node. So apparently the biggest one is Dallas. I'm not 100% sure that this database contains all the airports in the world, but well, it's what we get. Yeah. So you can do the same calculations using the relationship, the property, and you just need to specify this on the call. Again, when you do the string, it's only doing the select. You are not writing anything, you just show the output to the user. And also, you can execute the same that we are doing with the Python SDK. You can go to the prompt and do it here. Okay. What more? If you want to write the results back to the database, again, here we didn't do it. Well, we calculate the page run score, but this is something that is in memory. If you close the database, there is nothing happens. You need to calculate it again, and you will get, depending on the circumstances of the database, if nothing changes, you will get the same outcomes. If not, you will get different outcomes. If you want to write an attribute back to the graph, you need to use the method to write. You use the same algo. All the methods had four methods: write, string, mutate, and string. And then on doing write, you specify the name of the projection that you create, and you give a name to the property that you want to create. Where is going to create this property? It fully depends how you create the projections. Here in the projection, you say that this is the name, this is the node that you want to use, and this is the relation that you want to use to create the score. So the attribute is going to be created in the airport node. And now you go to the database, you will see if we take airport, we take one, come on, you will see that here we had paragraph page rank weight, and you see here that we have the same value that the original PageRank because it's created in very similar way. Again, what I did here is calculating the exactly the same that they calculate, because when you calculate PageRank unweighted, you are just counting the number of incoming relationships, no? And created an score. This score is, how to say, dividing by the number of total nodes that you have in the database, blah, blah, blah. You can see the formula, but if we didn't change the number of relationships that you had incoming, this parameter is not going to change as well. So the score is not going to change. Okay. If you want to weight it again, weighted, you have this option, and you want to write the result, you just need to write that. And here you can query the database. Here we wrote back to the database this new parameter, and you can now query the parameter. And you have here we just matching airport, the node airport, and return to me the description of the node. So the node is n, the variable n, the type of node is output, is airport, and return me the page rank weight and also the description of the node. And you see here the description. Sorry, the description is Jackson, Atlanta. Then here we are not saying any sorting, any how to say grouping. Just give me the 10 of the nodes of the database and return me these two values. Article run is a variant of the page run, but here we focus in the low degree nodes. The assumption here is that the low degrees node had more influence than the high degrees node. So let's imagine that you have a hierarchy of the in your graph, for example, let's imagine that you had something like a Active Directory where you have different groups. Inside a group you can have groups and users, and then groups is a node that of the type group, user is a node of the graph of the group of the type user. You have relationships that are in this group, but you have the users at different levels into the hierarchy. The way to evaluate in this kind of scenarios the page run algorithms is to use this variant with this article run, which you get a weight. You introduce a weight into the calculation according to the level or to the degree where the node is located. So again, as I mentioned at the beginning, you need to know very well how is created your algorithm, how the calculation is done, and it is really applied to your use case or not. And then on here, well, the way to execute it is exactly the same. You create a projection, you here estimate the memory you need, and you just clear here, create the score, really exactly the same. It doesn't change. The only thing that changes is the when you invoke the when you call the class, you just specify the type of algorithm that you can use. But again, it's going to be working in top of a projection, and you will get exactly the same output. Here, you want to drop a relationship, sorry, a projection like we have here. Let's try with this one. Query database. Let me drop that one. You can just execute GDS grad drop and you remove the projection. Okay. Now you had between centrality. Sorry, just give me a second. Soren bat. So between centrality, this is a very also very useful algorithm which helps you to detect nodes that are how to say in the middle of many paths. No, this is something that help algorithm which help you to detect nodes that can become a bottleneck, no, a place where everybody's going, and then you need to detect these kind of points in your graph to allocate more resources to these nodes. No, when you can use, what is the typical use case scenario? For example, this graph is one of the cases that you can use between the centrality. If you remember how is the graph is built, you had a relationship that is hash road. Hash road is a connection in between the airport A and airport B, a hat a distance. And then on one of the direct use of this node is to calculate the shorter path in between two different airports. No, this can help you to, well, to know how what is the best route to go from A to B, and you also can calculate cost, time, etc., and connected this to a central ticketing system, to an LLM, and provide whatever. And then in the previous video we use exactly this, using the sorted paths Dijkstra algorithm, we calculate the sorted paths in between two different airports. And then what happened in this scenario? In this node where we had around about 8,400 airports, it had to be some of the nodes that are more used than others. Let me give you an example. Let's imagine the airport in New Zealand capital, no? Or I don't know, New Zealand. And let's imagine the airport in Frankfurt, Frankfurt Main Airport, or Frankfurt Central. So it's clear that if you want to go from America to New Zealand, you probably will have some roads. Or not even from UK to New Zealand, you had two alternatives: or you go to USA, direction USA, or you go direction to Asia. Yeah, and then there is many of these airports in the middle of the graph that have that are in the middle of the shorter path, or in the middle of the path of the connections in between airports. And there is others which are at the edge of the path, and well, they had not not influence, but they are not broadly used. Just they are used if you go to that destination. But in the case of many airports in Middle East and also Turkey or Europe, those airports are broadly used because they are serving as a connection from America to Asia and Australia, and vice versa. And then, why is useful to use this algorithm? You can detect these hot points, these confluence points, and in this case, for example, dotate or allocate more resources to that points, because it's really not worth it to probably allocate resources to an airport that is, I will say, in Malvinas, no, in Falklands, no, in the islands in the south of Atlantic Ocean, no. Why? Because practically nobody go there. You need to have a connection, probably have a connection with Buenos Aires, a connection with London, but there is no further connections to this island. So you need to detect what are the hottest points in your network and take decisions in how to allocate more resources to that. No? And this is exactly what we are doing here. We use the between centrality, we just create again a projection, we calculate how long it takes, and here we are going to calculate the most influences nodes in the graph. You can see here we have Dubai, Los Angeles, Charles de Gaulle, Beijing, and Istanbul. From this description, what I understanding is that the probably not all the airports are, and not all the connections are correctly set up on this database. But this guy, the idea, the takeout from this is exactly this. Here, this is a variant as well. This help us to understand how the information is spread across the network. It's pretty similar in terms of working of the previous one, of the between centrality. Is another variant. Again, you can take a look to the documentation, and again, you need to. This is even slower than between centrality because it's calculating a score one node versus all the nodes in the graph, and it's taking a lot of time. That's why you usually take the three more. Influence node in the graph, which help to spread the information across the network. So, to be honest, I never use it, but it's there, it's implemented. And again, as I say several times, review the documentation and try to apply it to your use case. Also, I remark you again that this graph probably that I created is not fully applicable. Not all the algorithms are fully applicable to this graph, no? But okay, it's working. You can take a look, understand how it works. And again, here we just create the projection. Here we make the estimation, and here we are calculating the the total. Spread. This is a number that calculates the total spread across the network, the graph, and here you just take the three more relevant nodes in the network. Close centrality is giving you the nodes that better help to spread information across the network. This is broadly used is, for example, in some case scenarios where you had some nodes where everybody contact for doing something. Let me give you an example. You, it's like this person who is in, for example, in a community who is the third main point of contact. No, this algorithm help you to localize these kind of points. Again, in this case, probably is the graph is not helping a lot to understand this, but you can see here as well the kind of airports that we are getting. London, Heathrow, Frankfurt, Main, Amsterdam, those are airports which had a lot of traffic, internal traffic, traffic from closest countries. In Europe, there is a lot of connections in between the airports, not only for traffic in between them, also for transit to go into other directions. Degree centrality, pretty similar to the previous one. A second, sorry. He's very used, for example, trying to localize the nodes which had, for example, more, this case of the social networks, the people who had more followers. You can detect it using this algorithm, degree centrality. Again, this case probably is not the most appropriate. We can run it through, and you can see here what we get. No? Similarly, we get in this case we are using. So in a real scenario, you may use the relationship is follower. Or and then on, you had two different orientations, reverse or direct, and the property that you are gonna use, no? And then here, for example, you have a relationship is following and the property direct, for example, you are in a degree of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, being the follower of a person, you can calculate which is the person who not only having the biggest number of followers, also having the biggest number of second level followers, and so on and so forth. So again, I repeat again, probably you will be tired of that. Sorry here, probably that's true. I need to delete the graph before execute it again. So all these algorithms, you need to know how they calculate the score. In this case as well, you have an score by default not weighted. You can use weight as well, depending on the attribute that you use to weight the relationship and the score, and create the score, you're gonna get a different output, no? So better to read the documentation. Eigenvector centrality is another variant as well of the previous one, and just giving you the influence of the what they consider high scoring nodes in that make a bigger contribution than other nodes that had low scoring, no? that get low scoring. But again, read what the how is calculated this and check it is really applying to your use case. The way to execute it is exactly the same, and you can see here as well we get an score, the higher the best, or the most influence had the node into the network. And and again, to understand fully how this score make an impact in your graph, and it is going to be useful for your feature engineering, we need to be completely sure that this apply to your use case. In my mind, in this database, the only one which or the two ones that may have is closed centrality and pace run with weighting or without weighting. The others in the graph I'm doing this, probably they are not very useful, or directly they are not useful. Okay, that's all. Thank you very much for watching. I hope you enjoy with the video, you find it interesting and useful for your job. And I say usually, thank you for watching. Give me a like if you like the content, and subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before. I will upload the notebook to the repository, and then on you can well make your test and your and to go through the whole exercise in your local environment and enjoy with that. Thank you very much. Ciao, ciao.